Well, welcome here tonight. You're here, John's here, so we're ready to start on time. How we, the structure of the program is John will come up and he's going to give a presentation. After that presentation, we'll break into some small groups. And after that, John will come back up and we'll have some Q&A. When we started this back in May of last year, John was one of the first people who I wanted to come here. And Alex came that time from your group. And one of the reasons is I've seen John speak before. I think we're in for a wonderful treat. I think he really knows and understands our state economics, and better than just about anybody else I've heard.
Thanks for that introduction. My name is John Burbank. I'm the executive director of the Economic Opportunity Institute. Our mission is to build economic security and educational opportunity for middle class and low income workers and people in our state. That's what we focus on. We focus on the problems, but we also focus on the solutions. And we try to figure out how we can pragmatically put forward solutions at the state level, at the city level, and frankly, at the national level. And we've had quite a few successes. You all know about the minimum wage initiative back in 1998. That was the first initiative in the country, minimum wage, that was tied with an automatic COLA, so it kept up with inflation. We did the policy for that. We did the policy and actually drove the initiative to expand basic health back in 2001. We led the charge for family leave insurance in 2007, which passed, and it is law, but it's not funded right now for the state. And we also developed a wage ladder for early child education workers, which is now state law. So that just gives you a little rundown. Most recently, you're probably aware that we were the sort of the catalytic organization to get the city council here in this city to pass paid sick days. So we do this because we do have a dream for our commonwealth and how we as a people together can reach out and enjoy that American dream. As a people together, not just looking at each individual, but all of us together. That's why it's a commonwealth. So I was going to start this out by just asking about, what are your expectations of life in these United States? What is important that we have that we can count on? So give me some ideas. What's important?
Housing.
Education,
healthcare,
jobs,
security.
Clean water, security,
food,
quality. The quality of men and women. Okay.
Yeah, though I don't want my government taking the country to war.
Yeah, that's a really good one. Something that's sort of been lost in the last 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 years. Okay, well, this is my ideas I have. We want birth, a good birth, healthy growth, aspirations of hope, and health, right? We want the challenges of work. We want intellectual achievement, that we're not just cogs in the system, but that we are able to enjoy some of the intellectual challenges and growth and understandings and questioning and philosophy. And that actually is, I think, a big part of the religious inquiry. We want physical fitness. We want mental fitness. We want family and friends. We want comfort and opportunity and joy and security and a good death. Those are the things that I think begin to make up what are important and what are achievable and actually should be objectives that we demand are part of American life and are part of the foundation of American society. So what don't we have to meet these expectations? So we don't have a livable income for certainly at least about 50% of the population. And livable, I mean an income that enables you to not just live from check to check, but to have some security. Our wages, and this is, a lot of this has happened particularly in the last 10 years. It's not just a matter of the Great Recession, it's a matter of public policy over the last 30 years. We've had depression of wages. We don't have family leave. Every single other country has family leave. When you have a baby, you can take time off from work, get partial compensation, and care for that infant. It's like we don't have that, but every other country does. Secure pensions, right? We don't have those, and those are actually being undermined every day. The latest fiasco of Boeing was the best example of undermining the pensions for those workers, but also undermining the economic activity of the community, because those pensions are real drivers of economic activity and consumption in our communities. We don't have affordable childcare. Anyone who has kids here, little kids, could tell you that. I don't know if anyone here has little kids. I have big kids, but not little kids. But you know, childcare runs at about, seriously, about $1,800 a month for one child. You can figure out, make the calculations from that. We don't have, especially in our state, progressive and robust public revenue. You see, a lot of states after the Great Recession have made a flip and they're actually gaining a lot more public revenue. We're not. Why do you think we don't have much public revenue? Sales tax, and what's missing? Income tax, right. So, you know, we have one of the wealthiest states in the country. Seattle is the 10th wealthiest. Seattle has the 10th largest number of super wealthy households. That is, households that have $35 million more in wealth. But we leave all that money on the table. As a result, we don't really have affordable public higher education, because as state revenues have fallen, state investment in public higher education, like the University of Washington, has fallen. And what's happened to make up that gap is an incredible increase in tuition. And we don't have a secure retirement. Social Security, the average Social Security check, some of you can probably tell me this personally, but the average one is about, comes up to about $15,000 a year. That's it. And for two-thirds of the retirees, they're dependent upon Social Security for about 80% of their income. So that's what we don't have. And I want to explain a little bit why we don't have these things, but then I want to start talking about solutions and what we can do. So this is a graph that shows the increase in productivity from 1948 to about 2011. Now, what is productivity? Productivity is the amount of goods and services that one worker can produce. And as you invest more and more in technology, you get each worker able to produce more and more and more. And you can see that from after post-World War II to about 1968 or so, or 1970, that hourly compensation, and in fact the hourly wage, pretty much kept up with productivity. That is, the increases in the hourly compensation and the average hourly wage were comparable, proportional to the increases in productivity, which meant that those increases in productivity were split proportionally between workers and corporations. So it didn't mean that corporations didn't get any. They got some too, but workers got some too. But look what happened after 1972, and particularly right around 1981. What happened in 1981? Yeah, right. Ronald Reagan was elected. And income taxes, the percent of income tax fell dramatically. One of his first moves was to break PATCO, the Professional Air Traffic Controllers Organization, to send a signal to corporate America that it was okay to get rid of unions. Well, when you get rid of unions and workers lose bargaining power, what happens? They don't get their just compensation. So as productivity continues to go up, you have hourly compensation, and the hourly wage is pretty much flat. And this actually is a little bit deceiving, hourly compensation, because that includes things like healthcare benefits. But what it doesn't show you is that actually workers are paying Even though corporations may be paying more for healthcare benefits, workers are paying more for healthcare benefits as well over the last 20 years. So that's what does that result in? That results in this, where you can see that this is in deciles. So a decile is 10%, 10%, 20%, 30%. So the people between 0 and 10% in terms of wages, you can see that their growth, the blue is from 1979 to 2012. You can see that for the bottom decile, their wages fell 2% in that time. For the second decile, their wages fell 5%. For the third decile, their wages fell 5%. For the fourth decile, now we're talking about the middle class, their wages fell 6%. For the people in the very middle, their wages fell 5%. For the people in the 60th decile, their wages fell 2%. And then we start to get this growth, 1% for the 70th, 3% for the 80th, 6% for the 90th. And then if you look at overall growth, you can see the same pattern, but even more magnified over time. So while wage growth was stagnated overall, what wage growth did occur was really accruing to the very top. That doesn't do much good for the rest of us, but you can see what happens when that happens. The average market income, this is sort of interesting. So the average market income for the bottom 90% is $29,840. And for the top 1/100th of a percent, it's $23,846,000. Market income is income that doesn't include transfers, such as food stamps, TANF payments, unemployment payments. This is income from the private market or from public employment as well. All right, so this is another little picture. And this is interesting because on the one hand, we can see wages for, this is the typical male worker. You can see his wages have fallen by over $3 an hour since 1979, okay? And this is, keep in mind, this is an era of great productivity. Women's wages have risen, not by a lot, by about $2, but there's still this huge wage gap between men and women. And so this is not good news for either men or women in terms of their wages. And in terms of family leave, this just gives you an idea of what kind of an outlier we are. Just about 200 miles, not even 200, 150 miles north of us in Canada, they have 119 days of family leave. They get 55% pay. That's a good example. I actually have a lot of friends and have lived in Finland. In Finland, for the first year of family leave, you get compensation at 80%. If you choose to care for your child in year two and year three, your compensation is 65%. You're guaranteed that you have your job back. Okay, well, so let's go on. Here's the problem I was alluding to before, which is the percent of income paid in state and local taxes. Now, so it is an interesting phrase, percent of income paid in state and local taxes. So in some ways, we do have an income tax, right? It's the percent of income we pay in sales taxes. It's not called an income tax, but it's our income. And you can see that the poorest 20% that with incomes below 20,000, they pay almost 17% of their income in state and local taxes. I don't need to go through this, but the top 1% pay 2.8%. So when you have a tax system like this, and you're not taxing the tippity top, and you're overly taxing the bottom, but all the money is at the top, well, what happens? We don't have much public revenue. So this is just a good example of the Washington General Fund, the funding for higher education spending per enrolled student, right? So you can see that we were doing okay in 1999, 8,000. In fact, we were doing okay in 2007, almost 8,000. Now we've dropped literally $2,000 per student. This trend is did not start here. If you go back to 1980, the state of Washington paid for about 80% of the cost of education, so that, for example, when I went to school at Evergreen State College, My tuition was about $1,500 in today's dollars. The state was paying 80%, tuition was 20%. Now that's pretty much reversed. The University of Washington, the state contributes about 27%, tuition is about 73%. And that's true for the regional colleges. It's not as true for the community colleges. Right now, the state is paying about 48%, and tuition is about 52% at the community colleges. Okay, so what happens when you have this disinvestment is who makes up the difference is the parents, the students, and their parents. And you can see tuition, the University of Washington, rising from $3,200 to $12,383 over this time period. Similar rises in other state colleges and universities, which simply means that right now the University of Washington tuition by itself is almost a quarter of the typical household income. Think of that. That's before taxes. And you know, some families have more than one child. Some families have two children. So you can see this is really pinches typical families. And one of the real problems with this is that state need grants and state aid is really focused on families that are below the median income, like 70% below the median income. And as a result, people who are right in the middle are completely on their own. What happens? Students have to take out loans. And the average loan debt in Washington State now is $23,000 when students graduate, and is getting worse and worse. And you think about that. I bet none of you who are over the age of 30 had student loans, if you went to college, of over $10,000. And I bet the people here who are under age 30, I bet you do have student loans. Raise your hands. You got student loans? Yeah, okay, there you go. Because that's become, you've got a student loan too? Yeah, so that's become the way that we finance higher education is student loans. The banks love it. But it is a really bastardization of public higher education. All right, so we can talk a lot of problems, but I like to talk about what we can do for solutions. And I want to go over some things, and I want people to feel like this is not a problem that they're powerless to act on, right? We may feel like we don't have power at the federal level or even at the state level, but we certainly have power at the city level, and we actually do have power at the state level, and you can wind that up and we can have power over in a lot of different states and finally at the federal level. In fact, many of the great advances of FDR and Francis Perkins were not, they didn't dream of these things like Social Security and the minimum wage just off the top of their heads. These were programs that were started at the state level and then were federalized. And so one of the things that we have to think about in the long run of history is how we can use our programs to build a commonwealth, not just in our state, but in other states as well, and eventually across the whole country. All right, we did that, actually, with paid sick days. We had a little sort of organized a band of people back about 4 years ago talking about paid sick days. We tried to get it through the legislature, that didn't work too well. We tried in Tacoma, that didn't work too well. We tried in Seattle, and we had the right combination. We had a couple of city council members who were very interested. We had some unions that were very interested in moving this forward. And we built a great coalition of community organizations and unions to move forward paid sick days. Now, this would not have happened at the behest of the city council itself. We know that, right? When we started talking, they said, oh, we can't do that. That's not on our agenda for this year. So we said, okay, well, that's really interesting. How about if we put it on your agenda? And we did. And so we really led the way in terms of an ordinance which has then been replicated in Portland and replicated again in New York City. In New York City, unfortunately, our level, this labor standard kicks in when you have more than five FTE. So it doesn't include micro enterprises, which we did not want to exclude, but it was part of the bargaining process. In New York City, when they passed it, it included only those firms that had more than 25 FTE. And now with de Blasio becoming mayor, he wants to push it down to our level of 5 FTE. So we have actually created a great model for paid sick days in our state. And that's, you know, think about that. 160,000 workers did not have access to paid sick days in the city of Seattle. So when their child was sick at school, you'd have sometimes have children in the nurse's office pleading with the nurse not to call their mother or father, because they knew that if their mother and father had to come get them out of school, they might lose their job and their income. So certain basic humanities that are important with paid sick days, and the law has been in effect now over a year and a half, and all the sort of sky is falling predictions of business are just that. They're just sky is falling predictions of business, which don't really bear any resemblance to reality. So that's the first thing. Minimum wage is the second thing. So we have the best state minimum wage in the country. However, it still is not at the level of what it would have been, what it was in 1968 in terms of purchasing power. So it certainly is a good idea that we figure out ways of increasing the minimum wage. And in SeaTac, we saw that happen. And with Shama Sawant getting elected, we see that happening again. By the way, one of the reasons that Shama was elected is that her opponent was a fellow named Richard Conlon, who is the sole Seattle City Council person to vote against paid sick days. Important, powerful message. And so we're looking at possibilities for minimum wages. I'll go over that. And I'm going to go through all these things, so I'm not going to sort of just read through this list. Let's go on to, here's the Seattle Coalition for a Healthy Workforce, just showing that we didn't get this just from having a nice policy idea, but you had to build the power of citizenry to get it, to get the city council to realize that they better pass this or there would be consequences to pay. And indeed, there were consequences to pay. Here's a majority support for, this is the $15 minimum wage idea. This is a poll that was just taken. 68% support. What's interesting about this is support grows if you have a phased in minimum wage. So it goes to $15 an hour in 3 years. And this is how you can do that. So right now we're at $9.32. In 2015, you can beat $11. In 2016, $13. In 2017, $15. That equals to about a 18% increase for the first 2 years and a 15% for the in the last year. We've had percent increases of this in the minimum wage in 2000. We actually had employment growth at the same time we had increases in the minimum wage. And so actually, I think that this is, I'm hoping that this is a model that's taken up by, if it's not taken up by the city council and the mayor, then it would be taken up by the people through an initiative. If we can legislate the minimum wage, well, what about maximum compensation? Everybody talks about the 1% and how terrible income inequality is. Well, okay, this is a democracy, right? If we can legislate minimum wages, we can legislate maximum compensation. Here's the language right here. I'm not saying that this is going to happen right now, but you could actually say beginning such and such a year, every employer shall pay to each of his or her employees a maximum compensation not to exceed 250 times the state minimum hourly wage. That would be not to exceed about $5 million per year. There'd be a lot of objection to that, but it'd be very interesting. It'd be about time that we actually put the wealthy, well, the 1% and the corporations on the defensive rather than on the offensive, and this is one way of doing that. So, you know, one of the reasons why we have this decline in organized labor is essentially there's a sort of a legal attack on workers in terms of being able to organize into unions. And the federal NLR, National Labor Relations Act, is essentially flaunted by corporations all the time. You have captive audience meetings all the time, lots of threats to workers, like what we just saw with the Boeing machinist vote. So how do we fight back against something like that? I mean, it's really bad. It's not just bad for the workers themselves, it's bad for the economy, it's bad for the middle class. You have income and benefits that are taken away from middle class and upper middle class workers. You are draining resources out of that community. So how do we stop that? Well, one thing we can do is get a little bit creative. And we do have some civil rights laws that say that it's illegal to discriminate on the basis of race, sexual orientation, marital status, age, et cetera, et cetera. There's no reason why we couldn't also say that it's illegal to discriminate at work on the basis of union interest and activity. You could do it. It's pretty. You could insert that into the civil rights statute. And then you would have a new enforcement power, which would be the Office of Civil Rights. My colleague, Marilyn Watkins, we were talking at a staff meeting today, and she said, you know, it's even, employers can even tell workers that they cannot share with each other how much they get in wages. They can't have a discussion of their own wages. So you could insert into this something that's even, you know, smaller, which basically says it is illegal to discriminate against workers if they talk about their wages with one another. You could do that. Who are some of the most poorly paid workers in this city?
Garbage collectors.
Actually, garbage collectors are unionized and they're very well supported. What did you say?
Teachers,
child care workers. Child care workers are really poorly compensated. And you know, we have a lot of discussion about the need for high quality child care. This is like a mantra. Oh, we have to have high quality child care, et cetera, et cetera. And we have to make sure our low income kids have had high quality child care. But the funny thing is that none of these people are addressing what is the central factor of high quality child care, which is the compensation of the child care caregivers and teachers and workers. That compensation is in the bottom decile of compensation in Washington State. So how can you expect to have high quality child care if you pay your teachers so lousy that there's incredible turnover? There's about 60% a year. And so there are some real attachment issues of children with their child care providers and child care teachers. There's no incentive for child care teachers to get greater education at community colleges or four-year colleges because they're not going to get a wage bump. And so you essentially are completely sort of building what you consider a high-quality child care system on a false premise, that the child care workers are sort of widgets, passive widgets that just can provide the care. So what we did is we built this child care career and wage ladder. Very simple. It has a wage increments based upon experience, responsibility, and education. And the state would pay for those wage increments based upon education. And you would get a bump with each increase in your education. And all of a sudden, and this happened in Seattle and across the state in the early 2000 when it was implemented. You had child care teachers going back to community college, getting their early child education certificate, their AA certificate. You also had child care teachers who had a lot more self-esteem in their work, more pride in their work. What happened to the quality of child care? Well, that went up too. So we got this into state law. So it is now the state law. Unfortunately, it's not funded anymore. The funding was ended in 2011. But this just gives you an idea of how it works. So you can see these percentages or these. So for example, if you were to get an early child education certificate or an associate's degree, then you get an immediate bump of 50 cents. Not that it doesn't sound like that, but that's $1,000 a year. And if you're making $10 to begin with, $10 an hour, that actually is a pretty good bump. So this is another idea that could be incorporated into the early child education initiative that Tim Burgess is pursuing in the city of Seattle. Here's another idea, pay it forward. Who's heard about pay it forward? Some people. Okay, so this is an idea that originated with us, with the Economic Opportunity Institute. We talked about tuition. Here's an idea. You go to school without any upfront cost. That is, you don't pay for tuition or mandatory fees. You contribute after graduation, probably after about a two-year grace period, a fixed percent of income for a predetermined number of years to a higher education trust fund, and that fund enables the access under the pay-it-forward system to the next generational cohort of students who then are wrapped into pay-it-forward itself. So it has no upfront costs. It abolishes tuition, which has to be the biggest psychological and financial barrier to higher education for middle-class and low-income students. You then have free and open access to all qualified students. It increases career choice because when you graduate, you don't have to worry about making enough money to pay off your student loans. I have a friend who is now paying $600 a month on an income of $35,000. So she's paying over 20% of her pre-tax income for her student loans, and that's not unusual. And what this does is it zeroes out student debt. So this is how it would work. If you went to a community college here in Seattle, and it was you pay 1.5% of your adjusted gross income for 25 years, the first year, and this is based upon census data, so we can actually know what the typical income is of graduates of community colleges 5, 10, 15, 20, 25 years after graduation. Knowing that, we can project that they would be paying beginning at $15 a month. Who here has a, and then they would finish up at $52 a month. Anybody here have a cell phone? And
I
bet your cell phone bill is a lot more than $50 a month. Okay. This is also a way, interesting way of building this program over time. We know that corporations like Microsoft say that we need to have a lot more STEM education, right? That's sort of a mantra. And actually, that's just they're just pulling the wool over our eyes because they have a great business model right now. They pay really low taxes. They have tremendous tax loopholes. They don't have to worry about the state higher education system because they can just recruit workers from other countries and other states. So that works really well for them. But let's say they're honest that we need more STEM workers. How do you do this? Well, if we got Microsoft to agree to a tax of $12 million, we could incorporate, about 1,000 students with that $12 million at the University of Washington. Then if we have that $12 million over time, then as the students graduate and they make their contributions into Pay It Forward, then those contributions enable a gradual accretion of more and more students over time. So you can see that about every 10 years, you're going to have close to a doubling of the number of students for the same investment of $12 million a year. So it's a way to actually build over time the number of students who are able to have pay it forward free access to higher education. All right, well, I won't go into that for much longer because what I really want to do, my purpose about this is to have all you split up into groups and see which ones of these ideas make sense to you and what you'd like to do about it. I will talk about this, though. One of the things that we did as part of our work was to write and to develop the coalition for Initiative 1098. Does anyone remember that initiative? 2010. It was an income tax on incomes above $200,000. It was, it didn't work out very well at the end in terms of the vote, which I can talk about. But in terms of the vote in Seattle, Seattle supported this with a vote of 62%. So you think about this, can we do an income tax in Seattle? And yes, we can. We can do it as a privilege tax, and you can do it on, geez, is it a privilege to receive more than $1 million of income? I would think that's a privilege. And you could tax that privilege, the amount above, the marginal amount above $1 million at 5%. You could put that into a middle-class trust fund. You could use it to fund early child education. You could use it to fund higher education. This is an income tax. It's an income tax on incomes when you receive incomes above $1 million, and it's on the amount that's above $1 million. And actually, this is one of the reasons why this 5% might be, we might want to think about making that 2% to make it marginally Smaller so that just the transition cost of doing just what you're suggesting are a real deterrent. We could do that. But that was one of the things about the income tax proposal in 1098 is that we were accused that the rich people would move. Well, you know, you go down to California, the rich people didn't move and they have a higher income tax. But I guess the other point is, yeah, probably, maybe some rich people would move, but the total amount of income we get is going to be that much greater because not all the rich people move, just the real bastards move. So, that's a million. So let me ask you, who gets Comcast on their cable TV? Yeah, okay. Do you like paying those bills? Yeah, right. So, this is interesting. We have a neighbor to the south of us. Neighbor is called Tacoma. They have internet system through their public utility, through Tacoma City Light. It's called Click It. You can go there and check it out, but we could do the same thing here. It's actually makes a lot of sense. Public utility, it is a public utility. Right now there's a private monopoly. We could actually take over that public, that private monopoly and provide much better service. I want to talk about retirement a little bit. This is a picture of retirement in the United States. So how many people here have some sort of retirement savings? Because 54% of people don't have an employer-based retirement plan. Of course, I think the average age here is a little bit higher, so some of you are more retired than others. And you can see over the past 40 years that the people who are on a defined benefit, that number has dropped from 28% to 3%. What is a defined benefit? Defined benefit is a retirement plan that you are vested, that is, you have a right to this retirement plan after you've been working in a company for about 5 years. You know that when you retire, there will be a certain formula, and every single month you will get a check from that company or that company's pension plan until you die. Right? Now, there are some problems within that. So that is not necessarily, sometimes there's not a COLA, like I have a defined benefit from the Washington State Labor Council, and there's no COLA attached to it, so that value gets less over time. But it's much better than the defined contribution. So defined contribution is down here. You can see this has gone up again, and this is what Boeing sort of forced the machinists to trade off to. Defined contribution is when the corporation doesn't have any responsibility for the value of that defined contribution. They may put money into the plan, as Boeing has done, but they have no responsibility for what happens to the value of that plan. All the risk and all the responsibility resides with the employee. So you had people in 2009 who were going to retire, and all of a sudden they thought they had a 401k plan, and it turned out it was a 201k plan. And it creates a lot of insecurity in terms of how much money you're going to have. And for that matter, people aren't saying enough. I think the median value in a deferred contribution plan is about $30,000. $30,000. That gets you a monthly annuity of about $30 a month. Okay, so the whole thing about this is that we need to figure out how we're going to make sure that when people retire, they have some economic security and they're not worried about running out of money. A lot of them are going to run out of money in the current situation. But just to give you an idea about you're going to have this come up this month, or probably this month, is that there will be continual attack on the public pensions of public employees. And people think, oh, public employees, they're really getting away with murder. Well, that's their typical monthly pension, $1,400. And a lot of these public employees don't have Social Security. So $1,400, that's about $17,000, $16,000 a year, right? And there's moves to try to lessen that. But this is actually, this is something that we want to keep and actually build on. So be suspicious when you hear talk of gold-plated public pensions, because they don't exist. Okay, so, and one thing to keep in mind is people always forget about the economic impact of cutting pensions. So if you look at the Washington State, our public pensions generated about, $2.5 billion. And because it was spent in the community, it ended up generating about $3.5 billion in the economy in terms of economic activity. And if you look at the public contributions, which is about $388 million for those benefits, that generated $3.5 billion. The rest of this money came from investments of the pensions. So almost a 10-to-1 benefit from public contributions in terms of increasing economic activity. It's more of a multiplier effect. Because if you have, let me give you an example. If you have, let's say you have, $100 a week of additional money, how are you going to spend it? Well, most people will spend that within the local economy, right? They'll go to their grocery store, they'll go buy a coat, maybe they needed long underwear in January. I don't know. They're going to buy that. Okay, so you increase purchases, and this is actually happening now with the Boeing. Boeing did a bonus to the workers. They sort of bribed them. They gave them a bonus if they approved the contract. So you have this increased economic activity, which means that if you have more people buying things, you're going to need to, first of all, hire people to take care of the customers who are buying things, right? And you're going to need to buy more goods themselves, so that creates a production feedback as well. So it results in this sort of escalation of economic activity. It doesn't, but what you said is, this is a little bit confusing because this $388 million grew to this $2.5 billion through over time, like over probably 20 or 25 years, through investment, right, of these pensions by the state, and then this created this bump, this essentially $1 billion bump in the state economy. And as it's invested over time, say the state puts in public contributions, then that money is invested by the state investment board. It typically gets about 8% a year. That money then grows to this amount of money that when it's given to pensioners as pension benefits, it generates this amount of increased economic activity. We can talk about it later, but that's all right. So 50% of workers can't even save for retirement. What do we do about it? Well, there is a proposal in the legislature that we have helped to actually been working on now for 15 years. It's simply that, you know, as a small business person, which actually I run a public policy institute, but it is sort of like a business, right? And we decided we needed to get a retirement plan for our workers. So we had some people come in, right? And they all came in, they were dressed very nicely, and they had these beautiful charts. They were colored charts. They had all these nice, showing that their investments did better than the Standard & Poor's investments, and we should go with them. And the next day, we had another group come in, and they also were very nicely dressed, and they had very nice charts as well. And so what would a small business person do? Forget it. I don't have the information to make that choice. I have other things to do. I'm not going to try to mess around with trying to figure out what is a good retirement plan. The solution to this is to have the state develop a retirement plan that any employee and any employer in the state can participate in. And so you knock down the barriers of entry, you knock down the disinformation costs, you knock down the implementation costs for the employers, and you enable workers to save with a product that is portable from workplace to workplace to workplace. So that's what this is. And it's on the floor of the House right now. It will, I think, pass. It's probably not going to pass in the Senate. Why do you think it won't pass in the Senate?
Tom, Rodney Tom.
No, get a little more creative than that. All right, the financial community. The banks don't want, the current financial services industry doesn't want this. It's really, you think about it, how stupid are they in some ways? Because this is just pulling more money into the private financial services community. They don't want it though because they don't want to have government seen as a solution to a problem. The problem is that people aren't saving enough money. And they are frankly not interested in banking people who are contributing $25 a week or $25 a month to their retirement savings. The administrative costs are much too large. But they still don't want the government to provide the solution, even though probably a lot of the activity would be contracted out to the private financial services community. So they're blocking this bill, and they probably will succeed in blocking the bill. The other thing, though, is, okay, so let's say they block that bill. What can we do? Well, we can do a lot. We can build up Social Security. We can scrap the cap. Anyone know what scrap the cap is about? Oh, okay, well, if you go to this website, Just Scrap the Cap, you'll get a rap video with a retired machinist, a retired University of Washington employee. It's actually had a tremendous impact, and this is a way of having impact on the national discussion. We produced this rap video, and it has resulted in, I think, 180,000 hits on it thus far.
The real old school in the house.
Give it up for the geezers.
Had a golden years, all planned out. Small pension golf cart and a Florida house.
But Congress put a hit on Social Security, mugged us of our dignity despite our maturity.
Tax we paid, every check we earned. Time to collect, we the ones getting burned.
There's nothing we can do if we can't get paid, except eat cat food and drink Haterade.
Listen up, cuz, while we drop some knowledge, we raise our little boy, put him through college.
Only safety net is our next of kin. Look out, son, cuz we're moving in.
What? We're moving in.
What? We're moving in.
What? Pull out the couch, cuz we're moving in. No arguing.
No arguing.
Pull out the couch, cuz we're moving in. Name spinal twist, check my orthopedic kicks, cuz I stoop farther south than the Saint lunatics. I'm still getting play, and it's all thanks to Pfizer, keeping me stiffer than my Yankees cap visor.
My station wagon windows are dark with tint. I subscribe to Vibe, and I get the large print. They call me Martini, got substance abuse, cuz I'm always playing gin and sipping on juice.
Our son wants to know if we can pay the rent, but without benefits, we ain't got 50 cents.
We don't pack a nine, we're just strapped for funds, but we're still game killers for our bachelor son.
You're out of towns. Social Security payments are far from erratic.
It's broke and failing.
Don't believe that static.
This crisis is a fiction. There would be no debate if we all pitched in at the same tax rate.
There's a cap on how much millionaires pay, even though we all work like every single day.
These are the facts, but they're proven thin. So pull out the couch, cause we're moving in.
What? We're moving in.
What? We're moving in.
What? Pull out the couch, cause we're moving in. What? No arguing.
What? No arguing.
What? Pull out the couch, cause we're moving in. All right now, youngins, you're our last resort, cause sooner or later we'll be needing support.
If you don't want roommates, just learn this rap. It's only one line, shout, scrap the cap.
Scrap the cap. Scrap the cap. Throw your hands up, just scrap the cap. Scrap the cap. Scrap the cap. Throw your hands up, just scrap the cap.
And it has really turned the discussion, so scrap the cap has become a legitimate and important part of the discussion about Social Security, because when you scrap the cap, you can increase benefits. You can, for example, switch to the Consumer Price Index elderly, which is much more representative of the costs for living for an elderly person. You can add in survivor benefits for students. This is actually in the law up until 1981. So if you were a student and your mother or father died, you got benefits up until age 22 if you're going to college. That was changed just to age 18. And so you have a lot of students who have lost one or both parents who are just sort of left out to dry. We could change that. You could change the benefit calculator, which this is essentially just something that is completely discriminatory towards women. Right now, the benefits are calculated in your best 35 years for Social Security. Who here gets those Social Security? Well, you probably know all this stuff, so you can tell me to be quiet or not. But anyway, but the problem is that women's typical participation in the workforce is about 32 years. So in their calculations of benefits, there are three zeros. You can get rid of that by just changing the number of the years to be benefited from 35, the years to figure out the benefit from 35 to 30. And then you can just simply increase benefits. There's a lot we can do. There's a lot of activity going on. There's a group here that we helped organize called Social Security Works Washington. You can go to their website. They're leading the charge to getting our congressional delegation to signing on to a bill that will do just these things. Okay, family medical leave insurance. We talked about this a little bit, right? And we will have a bill next year to move this forward in our state. Basically, when you have a baby, when you're caring for an ill parent, when you're caring for an ill child, then you're entitled to family medical leave. If you have an injury off the job, then you're entitled to what's called temporary disability insurance. That also will be covered. These are just, you know, there's nothing rocket science about this. This is not like you know, pushing the envelope in terms of benefits for human dignity. Almost every single other country in the world has these sort of benefits, just not us. Not yet. Now, California has this benefit, right? You should know that. And New Jersey, where Chris Christie is, has this benefit. But so now we want to step up and have it here in our state. And then I'll just throw this out, public transit. We want BERTHA and 520. You know, BERTHA, that's like $2 billion we've already lost there, right? Or do we want to, you know, we had this great idea for a monorail. There was a certain city council person named Richard Conlon who was one of the most people who was vehemently opposed to the monorail and helped to kill it. But do we want a monorail? Might be a good idea. It's going to take us 20 years to build out the light rail. I mean, we'll have double the population by that time. We need full funding for Metro. We need to make transit work for everyone. We need the Transit Riders Union, if you know about them. So, and just to close up, here are some pathways that we like to use. City Council, not just in this city, but Tacoma and other cities. The legislature, initiatives, not just for the state, but for the city. I suspect that the minimum wage will end up being an initiative in our city. We need new revenue for dedicated public services. It's not just about taxes. We need social insurance programs, like Social Security, like Pay It Forward. We need to focus on communications and making the connections, sort of building the public trust, and you. And so it is a really good time to be a citizen and help to rebuild the middle class. So thanks for having me.